I'm Jenny Slate, and this is The First Time. I mean, I think the first time I probably performed improv was like at camp, where they would do the thing where you put like a bunch of objects in a pillowcase and then you pick one out and it's like a bottle of shampoo and you have to make up a thing, a skit right then as like a part of an evening activity. And I just remember being like, oh, okay, this is the most fun thing that a person can do. And I'm gonna always try to do it. A movie I made called The Sunlit Night, which we made in Arctic Norway, like just above the Arctic Circle. Kind of a big thing to choose for your first time you're going to try to do that, because it's just like, how do you even get like a dolly to a tiny archipelago of islands in the Arctic Circle? Interesting task to just like choose as, you know, like first time around. But I wasn't like in charge of that. It was way more of a, like, I was doing the creative guiding and there were other producers as well. I think it would be weird to take credit for getting a dolly up there or getting anything but my actual physical person. I'm just glad that I made it there, because you have to take like 50 planes and like 12 tiny ferries, but then you get there and it is astounding. I had moved to LA, but I was back in Brooklyn, and I went to my old neighborhood and I wanted to visit my next door neighbor who had gotten a hip replacement. And so I was like on my way to her house, a woman walked by me in the park, and I guess she had just been to see Obvious Child, and she like gave me a little round of applause. But I was on the phone with my mom, which is always a 9-hour conversation during which I say, and could not get off the phone. And so I just like blew her a kiss. And then she tweeted at me like, you blew me a kiss in the park. Would you ever read my book? And I said, yes. And then I read her book and I was like, oh, I love your book. What's up with you? Who are you? What's your deal? And then she was like, oh, well, my name is Rebecca Dinerstein. And actually, they're making a movie of my book. And that is how we got into conversation about it. The first time I smoked weed was on the eve of Y2K. I was on like the top of a hill in either New Hampshire or Vermont, but who could ever know? I smoked the weed, and I mean, I've said this before, but I smoked the weed and I was like, I love you! Like, I was just like, oh, this is everything to me now. This is gonna become like everything to me.
I ordered like 4 pizzas and like ripped into a bong and was just like, well, I don't know, man.
And then I was like, this is the best experience of my life. And then the next thing I knew, I was down at the bottom of the hill and I was like looking up at the, like at the stars, and there were all these cows around me. And I was just like, it's Y2K. When I was working at a bakery in Brooklyn, like right out of college, and I was the early morning like person who would open the bakery up and put everything out and make the coffee for people on their commutes. And I really liked that. It would be very slow after the morning rush. And then I would like clean up and I would read. I would like read a book behind the counter, which is not that big of a deal. But I remember the manager was this like really unkind woman. She had an issue with me reading, even though I was like always putting the book down when anyone would come in. And I just felt like she had a tiny bit of authority and she used it to jump right up my ass, which was not permitted. I was like, cool, got it. This is like definitely not worth my time. I'm not doing anything wrong and you have a really bad personality. And I left. I just like left. And then she called me and she left a message and she was like, hey, Jenny, it's blah, blah from blah, blah. I just want you to know you left your precious book here. I'd be happy to throw it out for you. And I was like, go ahead and throw out a book, you fucking monster. See how it feels? You're going to throw a book in the trash. You're going to throw Gabriel Garcia Marquez in the trash this afternoon. Go ahead. I was very stoned at a wedding in Pomfret, Connecticut. I was there, I was stoned, I was in a motel room with 4 other people, 4 friends. That was we could all afford like that room. And I just felt really small, and I like started like just like talking like a little voice like this.
Guess what I wear as a hat?
What?
A lentil.
And like just like a little voice, and everyone was like, whoa, what is that? And that sort of persisted through the weekend. And then eventually it became what it was. The first time that I played Mona Lisa on Parks and Rec, I was very shy, being a fan of the show and like knowing that, you know, I think it was like they were in their fifth season, and the character had been written for me by my friend Joe Mandy. And he was like, we wrote you this character, would you come and do it? And then I found out that she was the worst person in the world.
For the record, would hit hard pass.
And I was like, sorry, I just, super quick. So you're saying you wrote this for me, or not based off of me, but just for me, for my skill set. Anyway, but it was really fun, and I was really, really excited about the costumes. The first time that I met Gillian Robespierre was in a bar. I have a friend, he's still alive and I still like him. His name is Jed, and he was at the time like DJing after one of my stand-up shows. I had just done a set that was like a 15-minute set all about like masturbating on the arm of a couch as a child. As an adult, I go to a private space, but as a child, I didn't understand that. And he was like, oh, this is my friend Gillian. She just wrote a short film that she wants you to be in. And that's when we met each other. In 2019, after, you know, a decade of doing stand-up and not really ever wanting to make a special, I don't really care about getting it like perfect or, and I have a sort of aversion to the idea that you might be doing material in order to get to a place where it can finally be recorded, because every performance is worth something. And certainly if you're living that way, like, you know, a performance that I did that was, I think, you know, really good in front of like 75 people is just as important to me as that special, for sure. It was the worst show of my life. I walked off stage and I like burst into tears and was like, I just fucked myself. I can't believe I feel this way. After all these years, I knew I never should have done it. The next day, Gillian Robespierre, who directed Obvious Child and directed my special, had me come to the theater early. I had a drink, which I hadn't had the night before. I was like, I'm gonna do this without having like one drink. And then I had a drink that took the edge off for me. And we completely dismantled the set. We made new notes. And she was like, if you wanna do something new tonight, just do something new. And so I did what we had kind of dismantled and put back together. And then I did a lot of new stuff.
First of all, midnight, way to go. Jewish people are like, it's sundown, you better stay inside.
So it was like a complete experience from start to finish. And it went from difficult to satisfying. I think I've been crying at music for my entire life. Different cryings have occurred. On Passover, when you're 4 years old and they like open the door for Elijah and it's night out and your whole family is like weirdly behind you in the house being like, Eliyahu. It's so scary. And so you like stand at the front door waiting for the what, Messiah? Being like, ah! I remember crying about that. And I also remember really crying at the end of A League of Their Own when they play that Madonna song. This used to be my playground.
This used to be my playground.
Yeah, my dad and I both cry at that song.